Welcome back to another episode of 40 Facts About the 40K Universe. I am your host, Gershwin, and you are watching One Mind Syndicate. Today we continue talking about the Tyranids as we get into High Fleet Kraken. If you're new to the channel, subscribe. We post Warhammer 40K content every single day. And if you have any suggestions, please comment down below. But with that said, let's get into 40 Facts on High Fleet Kraken. High Fleet Kraken was the second major Tyranid High Fleet to invade the galaxy. It was responsible for the outbreak of the Second Tyrannic War, which began officially in the year 992 of the 41st millennium, and ended only after the Ultramarines chapter of Space Marines successfully broke the back of the Tyranid invasion in Imperial space at the Battle of Ikkar IV. And the Eldar of Craftworld Yondin successfully defended their home against the Tyranid horde. The invasion began 250 standard years after the First Tyrannic War, and the destruction of High Fleet Behemoth by the Ultramarines on their homeworld of Macragge. An armed presence had been maintained in the galactic southeast, which members of the Imperium's Adeptus Administratum began to question the need for, arguing that Behemoth had been the sum total of the Tyranid race's expansion into the Milky Way galaxy. When worlds along the eastern fringe of the galaxy began to erupt in rebellion, terrorism, riots, and sabotage, the same adepts claimed that the people were dissatisfied with living amid an armed camp. The Inquisition's Ordo Hereticus became suspicious of the adepts' dissent and their downplaying of the situation on the eastern fringe, and began an investigation which established that all the dissenting adepts had either come from the southeastern region of the galaxy or had traveled there at some point. This was the only link between the members that could be found, and some had never even met each other. Inquisitors were also deployed from Talissa Prime to investigate the planets of the Ultima Segmentum that were most troubled. Purges were made within the Imperium, especially on Terra, focused on suspected traitors to the Emperor within the Administratum, who had contact with the affiliated regions of the Eastern Fringe. Tens of thousands of suspected traitors were sent to prison colonies and the Imperial Guard penal legions by the Inquisition. Yet by the year 990 of the 41st millennium, High Fleet Kraken had already sunk its tendrils into the galaxy, isolating many Imperial worlds before any astropathic warning could be sent. High Fleet Behemoth had fought in a single wave that had advanced across the galaxy as a single organism, but the Kraken was actually a series of smaller, separate Tyranid High Fleets that moved to attack many human-settled planets simultaneously. This not only increased the difficulty of the Imperium's defenders in opposing the High Fleet, but also increased the area of the Hive Mind's psychic shadow in the warp. Almost overnight, an entire Imperial sector was silenced from Terra, isolated from the astropath's messages of warning by the potent powers of the Hive Mind. Only several months after High Fleet Kraken's onslaught had already begun did the first few survivor accounts of the attack begin to reach the wider Imperium due to the terrible turbulence in the warp. Whole planets had been wiped out by the Tyranids in only a few hours, and the Imperium of Man once more faced an unimaginable threat. But before the true threat revealed itself, the Imperium had first faced uprisings on its eastern fringe that served as the prelude to the main Tyranid threat. One such rebellion occurred on the hive world named Ikkar IV. Ikkar IV was vital to the operations of the eastern fringe, as its huge manufactorums formed the center and linchpin of one of the most densely populated Imperial sectors in the widespread Ultima Segmentum. The entire planet had been seized from the control of the Imperium by a religious fundamentalist group named the Brotherhood. Years before, the Brotherhood had captured the heart and minds of the population of the planet by preaching the return of the Emperor in physical form and promising better times to come. This was the sort of promise that was sought by the workers of the Ikkaran Manufactorums because they lived lives with no power, hope of betterment, or freedom. The Brotherhood quickly set up missions and chapels throughout the poor regions of the planet. The Ecclesiarchy closely monitored the Brotherhood for any signs of corruption or heresy, but none could be found. Eventually, permission was sought and granted for the construction of the Brotherhood's cathedral in Lomas, the biggest city on Ikkar IV. Shortly after the completion of the Brotherhood's cathedral, the trouble began. The Brotherhood refused to pay its tithes to the planetary governor, and would not allow its members to be inducted into Ikora's 4th Planetary Defense Force. Brotherhood preachers whipped the Ikoran population into a frenzy, prophesizing that the Emperor would return in the flesh soon. Brotherhood militias began to roam the streets, punishing anyone they deemed to be unbelievers rather than actual criminals. Events accelerated when rioting broke out during a mass demonstration outside of the Great Cathedral in Lomas. Arbitrators of the Adeptus Arbitus moved in with power mauls and suppression shields to put down the rioters forcefully, but were fired upon by the Cathedral's Brotherhood militia. The arbitrators returned fire and killed several of the Brotherhood's militia members. This only enraged the mob further, and they surged forward several times, eventually forcing the arbitrators to fall back, especially as another larger mob had just arrived to support them. Rioting then spread across the planet, and most of the forces of the Arbitus were forced back. When the Planetary Defense Force was called in to restore order, most of the members of the force rebelled and joined the ranks of the Brotherhood. Eventually, news of the assassination of the planetary governor reached the public, and vicious fighting broke out in all of the hive cities of the planet. Within hours, tanks decorated with the revolutionary banners of the Brotherhood were seen driving down roads in cities, pushing the Arbitus back. With the dawn, news of the assassination of the Imperial Governor and most of his ministers had spread over the entire planet, and the Brotherhood quickly seized control of several broadcasting stations, announcing the establishment of their new theocratic state in the name of the returning God Emperor. The Arbitus still held control of the majority of the Ikoran countryside and the Arbitus fortresses that guarded the center of Lomas. Most of the cities had been captured by the Brotherhood, denying the Arbitus vital resources. Inquisitor Agmar of the Ordo Xenos arrived 27 days after the rebellion began, on the same day that the Arbitus fortress in Lomas was overrun by Brotherhood forces. Most of the judges in the fortress escaped, moving to take control of the 4 main power stations of the city. Inquisitor Agmar saw this as much more of an organized rebellion than a sporadic outburst of popular religious feelings. He called for the support of the Ultramarines chapter of the Astartes to help the forces of the Imperium retake the planet, while the remaining Imperial forces waited for the arrival of the Ultramarines. They bombarded the rebel cities and pushed back vicious assaults by the Brotherhood militia battalions. Repeated attempts to reach the power station of Lomas failed, and 6 days after Agmar arrived, the Arbitus detonated several melta bombs, completely destroying the generators. Now the war transformed into a long, grinding campaign of urban combat, with casualties spiraling upwards daily. Every doorway could possess a booby trap, and there were Brotherhood snipers in place all over the renegade-held cities. Entire Imperial Guard patrols that remained loyal to the Imperium disappeared without a trace in the chaotic maelstrom. The rebellion promised to be a long one, as the Brotherhood held the armories of the Imperial Guard regiments assigned to the planet, and had the support of the majority of the Ikoran population to draw on to become soldiers in its militia. Inquisitor Agmar led several small forces of Imperial Guardsmen and arbitrators into Lomas to uncover the true nature of the Brotherhood. He was slowly piecing together the story when in a chance raid, he slew a neophyte of the Brotherhood and saw what manner of Xenos creature was actually leading the revolt. Foul, tyrannid gene stealers. Agmar sent an astropathic message confirming his fears of another Tyranid invasion to the Inquisition, and waited the arrival of the Ultramarines. 39 days after the Ikoran rebellion began, the Ultramarines battle barge Octavius entered orbit over Icarus IV and deployed its drop pods. The planetary defenses were largely inactive due to the damage to the power generators of Lomas, and as soon as the Space Marines landed, casualties were light. The Space Marines secured the Imperial Guard's armories and the Imperial Governor's palace, and fought off several poorly organized counterattacks, causing massive casualties among the Brotherhood's forces. Outside, the remaining Imperial Guard forces launched coordinated attacks to link up with the Ultramarines, using their Leman Russ main battle tanks as moving strong points, and slowly, inevitably, the Brotherhood's line bent back. More than 20 veteran Space Marines in Terminator armor from the Ultramarines' elite First Company teleported into the Great Brotherhood Cathedral in Lomas and destroyed the cathedral's defenders after Agmar sent a message to the Octavius via spy satellite. More guards appeared from side doors, and a storm of las beams and autoshells ripped out, massacring many of the Brotherhood guards, but not before several of the Terminators were dragged down. The Terminator's single heavy flamer proved to be invaluable, its flames incinerating the unprotected assaulting forces. Yet some of the Brotherhood neophytes were striking out with inhuman speed and terrible claws, indicating their Xenos heritage. The Terminators then spread out and searched for the maraud of secret passages that they presumed existed beneath the Brotherhood's cathedral. They soon found one under the altar, and the altar was quickly removed. As they moved down into the crypt, they heard the clattering of claws on stone. As the creatures jumped into the light of the Ultramarines, they were identified as Gene Stealers. This showed the Inquisitor's belief that there was a Gene Stealer coven at the heart of the Brotherhood's revolution to be correct. The battle began and raged for a long time. Hundreds of Gene Stealers died, piling up one on top of each other. Eventually, the Horde's number were spent in their attack. Several Ultramarine Terminators had been killed as their armor was torn open by the inhumanly sharp claws of the Gene Stealers. The remainder of the Astartes moved further into the crypt without encountering more of the creatures. Deep beneath the city of Lomas, they found a huge cavern where the huge and bloated great-grandfather of the Brood, the powerful Gene Stealer Patriarch, sat. As the Terminators approached, another horde of Gene Stealers, intent on protecting the alien master, attacked the Terminators from out of nowhere. Storm bolters rang, resulting in pure carnage. The company librarian fought his way to the dais, but the Patriarch used its psychic powers to attack the Space Marine Psyker. A surge from the Astartes psychic hood broke the spell, and the librarian forced its body out of the real world for an instant and then reappeared, teleported onto the dais. The creature lashed out, and blood and sparks flew from the librarian, but the Patriarch easily parried the return blows. The librarian called on his battle brothers for assistance, and the dais was swept with bolter fire. Some shells pierced the power armor of the librarian, but the Patriarch was also wounded. The librarian used this opportunity to strike with his force axe, the librarian's own psychic power behind the blow, allowing the weapon to tear through the tough hide of the Patriarch. The Patriarch was dead, suddenly leaving the Brotherhood and the entire revolution leaderless. The revolution felt the death of its leader and lost its impetus and cohesion. The remaining Terminators slew the rest of the Gene Stealers, and the battle above slowly stopped as the revolutionaries could only retract themselves and no longer act in a fully coordinated manner without the Patriarch's subtle psychic guidance over the cult. Small groups of Brotherhood acolytes and neophytes held their position in bunkers and towers, but were soon destroyed by the tanks and heavy fighting vehicles of the Imperial Guard. Ikra IV was back under the control of the Imperium, and all remnants of Gene Stealer cults, the Gene Stealers, their hybrids, infected humans, cult members, and traitors, was ruthlessly wiped out. Inquisitor Agmar, leading the Ultramarines, methodically purged the planet, which eventually returned to normal. There were still questions that remained unanswered. One was the fate of the human leaders of the Brotherhood, and his body was never found. The second was that the planet's astropaths had reported a shift in the warp, distant still, but the oldest of the astropaths had sensed the psychic call of the Gene Stealer Patriarchs radiating out into space and felt the change in the warp. He had sensed something vast and shadowy, a monstrous entity which had turned its attention toward Ikra IV, Highfleet Kraken. The horror stories that attended Highfleet Kraken's coming to Imperial space were numerous. Among the many tragedies of this time were the following. In the Myral system, Imperial Guard regiments and the Space Marines of the Scythes of the Emperor chapter held out against the Tyranids of Highfleet Kraken, who had overrun the lush jungles and plantations of Myral Prime. The Imperial forces retreated to a huge mesa called the Giant's Coffin, where they defended against the vicious hordes of Xenos that infested the dense jungles below. The flora of the planet itself had become mutated since the first miasmic spore of Highfleet Kraken had fallen on the world, and eventually only constant defloration with flamers prevented the Tyranid spore-infected creepers from engulfing the Giant's Coffin. A rogue trader brought rumors of a feral world of Larnoro in the Imperium's heart, a planet that had come to be ruled by the celebrants of nihilism, a heretical doomsday cult whose adherents had taken care to match the prophecies with the dire events of the time. When the elements of Highfleet Kraken arrived on Larnoro, nearly 75% of the population had calmly marched toward the Tyranid bioship to be consumed by their new gods. The rogue trader also brought a tale from the giant asteroid monastery of Salem, which told how the monks had chosen to poison both themselves and their carefully terraformed ecosystem, rather than allow all to be consumed by the Great Devourer. Another dedicated Imperial merchant captain helped evacuate millions of Imperial citizens from the mining world of Delvin's system before it was consumed. Delvin's extensive system of Nova Storm space stations held the High Fleet at bay long enough for the fleet of a giant Oro fighters to escape into the warp. A company of Space Marines of the Lamenters chapter held off the attack of the Tyranid warriors until the last starship had been loaded, though the Space Marines in the end sacrificed their own lives so that many more might live. Even those who fled successfully found little respite from the horror. One of the giant Oro fighters fleeing Delvin arrived at the world of Arda's Hope, ominously dark and silent. Those that were investigating the ship's automated landing discovered that within lay a blood-drenched abattoir where thousands of refugees, men, women, and children, had been mercilessly butchered by the Tyranid organisms that had breached the starship's quarantine, even as it fled. Only 3 weeks later, the planet itself was a blood-soaked ruin of a world the Great Devourer had claimed even more victims. Seen at a galactic scale, Highfleet Kraken was attacking across a front that covered thousands of light years. Some worlds were bypassed, isolated by the Highfleet's shadow in the warp, or attacked unexpectedly, making a cohesive Imperial defense almost impossible to mount. The Imperium was forced to concentrate its force on the most strategically important Forge Worlds and Hive Worlds, while it evacuated or simply abandoned to other horrific fates many other. Still, there were some bright moments for the Imperium. Several Space Marine chapters dedicated their forces to saving worlds the wider armies of the Imperial Guard had abandoned. Some, such as the Lamenters and the Scythes of the Emperor, found their once proud chapter reduced to a few scattered remains as the price of their valor, while the Knights of Eternity chapter is presumed to have been completely obliterated. Others carried the battle to the Tyranids as only the Space Marines can, striking at isolated tendrils of the Kraken, boarding hive ships and blowing them apart from the inside. Yet, no matter the efforts of the Imperium, the Tyranids were too numerous and drove ever deeper into the galaxy, toward the heart of the Imperium. Fortunately for humanity, Highfleet Kraken did not remain divided into separate tendrils indefinitely, and eventually began to coalesce into a single, massive swarm on Ikora IV, the Hive World, whose larger gene-stealer infestation had been the initial harbinger of the Kraken's arrival in the Milky Way galaxy. As Highfleet Kraken approached Ikora IV, thousands of gene stealers suddenly burst from the underhives in support of the invading Xenos, giving the lie to claims that the infestation had been entirely purged earlier years. Defense perimeters were completely overrun, Imperial Guardsmen slain by the thousands. In the terrible confusion, an ever larger number of Tyranid organisms made planetfall. Not only termagants and gargoyles that had composed the vanguard of the Pyre assault, but the truly monstrous Carnifexes and Tyrannofexes as well. Worst still, gigantic Herodules and Herophants, Bile Titans, stalked across the surface of the beleaguered world. The Tyranids had unleashed on Ikora 4 every terrible organic weapon in their arsenal. Despite all of this, Ikora 4 was not yet lost to humanity. Forewarned of Tyranid interest in the world by previous gene stealer infestations, the Imperium was able to mount a more solid counter-defense in the Ikora 4 system than in other areas of the Eastern Fringe under the assault of Highfleet Kraken. Chapter Master Marnius Kalgar, the Lord of Ultramar and hero of the First Tyrannic War, led the Ultramarines into the battle against their old foe on Ikora 4, just as he had against the Highfleet Behemoth on McCrag 200 standard years earlier. The Ultramarines inflicted crushing losses on the Tyranid Armada in space above the planet, and in the claustrophobic corridors of the towering Ikora and Hive cities. Space Marine veterans of the First Tyrannic War made planetfall, and scored Ikora's Force Hives in a series of close-quarter battles that lasted for close to a full Terran year. By employing the same tactics that had proved successful in defeating the Highfleet Behemoth in Ultramar, Marnius Kalgar rallied the Imperial defenders of Ikora 4 and cast the Tyranids from the planet forevermore. But as always, victory against the Tyranids had come at a terrible price. Ikora 4 was reduced to a smoking, charred house of death and destruction, a world and its people sacrificed so that the Imperium of Man might endure yet another storm. The first warning the Eldar of Craftworld Yondan had of the danger possessed by the Tyranids of Highfleet Kraken was brought in the year 992 of the 41st millennium by the Craftworld's far-roaming rangers, those Eldar whose instincts drive them to a life of exploration and danger, and who secretly monitor the planets and alien races near their Craftworld. The news that the rangers brought was terrible indeed. A Tyranid high fleet of immense proportion was heading towards Yondan's Craftworld. Already over a dozen Imperial planets had come consumed by the Tyranid's advance, and although the human Imperium was mounting a ferocious counterattack, it would be months until a major Imperial task force could be fully mobilized to deal with this threat in this area. By the time the Imperial frontier was established, the Eldar of Yondan knew that their precious Craftworld would have been overrun. Farseer Kelmon, political leader and spiritual head of the Craftworld, called together the Eldar of Yondan and warned them of the impending Tyranid assault. Each Eldar Craftworld had a great hall known as a Place of Answering, which is capable of holding every member of the Craftworld's population. At times of emergency, the Eldar met there so that all may know of the peril that faced their Craftworld, and so that any Eldar might voice an opinion on the course of action that should be taken. Only once all views had been debated and consensus reached would the Craftworld's Farseer decide on the course of action to be taken. The debate by the people of Yondan on the action to take against Highfleet Kraken's approach was heated and prolonged. The most conservative elements of the Craftworld argued for a policy of isolation, shielding the Craftworld behind a powerful psychic shield in an attempt to avoid all contact with Tyranids. The more aggressive elements wanted to attack the Tyranids immediately, dispatching the fleet to destroy the Tyranids before they reached the Craftworld. Both course of actions were problematic, because they took no account of the sheer size of the Tyranid High Fleet. It took a powerful speech from the Ranger Irelith, who had seen the High Fleet at first hand and understood the terrible threat that it represented, to sway the assembled Eldar. For over an hour, she drove home to all present that it would take the combined efforts of every Eldar on Yondan to have any chance to turning back the Tyranids. Even then, they might not succeed in defeating the alien menace. A hush fell on the hall as Irelith finished her speech. No more needed to be said, for all the Eldar present now realized their sheer enormity of the task ahead. Farseer Kelmon rose and ordered that the Eldar prepare the defense of Yondan Craftworld. All elements of the fleet would be recalled, and every single Eldar must take the warrior aspect of warlock, guardian, or aspect warrior for the first time in Eldar history since the fall. The entire Craftworld would be fortified, for there could be no doubt that the Tyranids would breach their outer defenses and land on the immense worldship.
Help must be requested from other Eldar craft worlds. The Avatar, the embodied spirit of the craft world's war god, Kaelin Mesha Kane, must be awakened to take part in the battle. And most terrible of all of the craft world's ancient spirit stones must be plucked from their resting places and implanted in cybernetic exoskeletons to battle as ghost warriors. As many Imperial scholars know, when an Eldar dies, its spirit is released into a gem known as a spirit stone, which is grafted into the very structure of their craft world to preserve the dead's Eldar consciousness and prevent it from migrating into the warp, where it would be devoured by the god Slaanesh. Thus, each craft world is actually a living, intelligent being which preserves a little of the once great Eldar civilization. By risking the destruction of the craft world's spirit stones, Kel'mon risks the destruction of Yandan's culture, racial memory, and literally the souls of its people. It was a grave chance to take, but Kel'mon knew that the Ghost Warriors could make the difference between victory and defeat in the struggle that was coming. The first Tyranid hive swarm attacked Yandan just 20 days later. By then, the craft world had already been isolated for over a week by the hive mind's shadow in the warp, which made it extremely difficult for other Eldar craft worlds to send help from the webway or psychic communication with their brethren. Apart from a few scattered units that made it through, Yandan ultimately fought the Tyranids on their own. Nonetheless, the first Tyranid wave were dealt with easily and effectively by the Eldar fleets. The Eldar spacecrafts were faster, more maneuverable, and had longer range weapons than their opponents. In battle after battle, the Eldar spacecraft destroyed the lumbering, biomechanical Titan hive ships while only suffering minimal casualties themselves. For a while, it looked as if the Eldar fleet might be able to hold off the Tyranids on its own, as wave after wave of Tyranids were wiped out. But Farseer Kel'mon was not convinced. Already, the ability of the craft world's Wraithbone forges to replace destroyed Eldar spacecraft was being far outstripped by the casualties being suffered in the deep space battles that raged across the craft world. The Eldar fleet was being ground down in a massive battle of attrition, a battle that only the Tyranids with their vast superior numbers could hope to win. As if to confirm Kel'mon's worst fears, the next Tyranid wave was massive, very nearly twice the size of any that had hit the craft world so far. The Eldar fleet suffered terrible casualties in its attempt to hold the Tyranids off, and for the first time was unable to stop them from landing on the craft world itself. Although the landing was wiped out before any serious damage was done to Yandan's defenses, the Eldar fleet as a large-scale fighting force had ceased to exist. Still, there was hope, especially if the wave had represented the Tyranid High Fleet's main assault force. The Eldar's morale was raised even more as the next Tyranid wave turned out to be tiny in comparison to what had come earlier. Although the weakened Eldar fleet could not keep all the swarm away from the craft world, the landings that were made were easily isolated and destroyed. For a short while, it seemed that the Eldar had weathered the terrible storm of High Fleet Kraken. Then, Yandan was hit by two huge Tyranid attacks in rapid succession. The pitfall remnants of the Eldar fleet opposed the Hive Swarm as best they could, but were ultimately swept aside by a tide of living alien spacecraft. Yandan was all but engulfed as horde after horde of Tyranid warriors, gene stealers, Gaunts, and Carnifexes were disgorged onto the craft world's surface and interior. Huge battles erupted all over Yandan, the fighting bitter and close range with enemy forces, often only separated by the width of a corridor of Wraithbone wall, as the Eldar desperately attempted to beat off the alien invaders. Often they succeeded, but the Fortress of Tears, the Shrine of Asurion, and most terrible of all, the ancient Fortress of Silence, repositories of the flora and fauna of all the lost Eldar homeworlds of Yandan, all fell to the Tyranid hordes. The Eldar furiously countered attack, the raging figure of the Avatar of Kane leading the craft world's Aspect Warriors, Guardians, and Wraithguard, and Wraithlord Ghost Warriors in a berserker orgy of destruction which recaptured the Fortress of Silence from the Tyranids. It is said that the Eldar warrior swept tears of rage and sorrow to see the damage inflicted on the ancient fortress dome of their craft world. Slowly, the Eldar managed to turn the tide on the Tyranids and gain the upper hand, forcing them back onto the defensive. And then another huge Tyranid wave arrived, the third in succession, and the largest yet, as swarm after swarm flickered into existence on the Eldar scanners. Kelmon knew that, bearing a miracle, Yondan Craftworld was doomed. Over 50 standard years before the Tyranid assault, High Admiral Yeriel, an Ultrok that led the Yondan fleet, although he was considered one of the greatest Eldar naval tacticians to have ever lived, his character was flawed by the sins of pride. When Yondan had been threatened by the Chaos Space Fleet raiding out of the Eye of Terror, Yeriel had led the Eldar fleet on a preemptive attack on the Chaos Fleet's flagship, leaving the Yondan Craftworld unprotected. He only returned just in time to stop a suicide attack by a small flotilla of Chaos Raider ships, who nonetheless managed to damage the Craftworld. Expecting to be feted and honored for his victory, Yuriel was deeply angered when he was called upon to defend his course of action. Claiming that his record should speak for itself, Yuriel refused to enter into the debate, leaving his old friend Farseer Kelmon no choice but to elect a new High Admiral in his place. Bitter with rage, Yuriel had vowed that he would never set foot on Yondan again. He and a small band of followers left the Craftworld to pursue the path of the Outcast and formed an Eldar Corsair company known as the Eldrith Raiders and became the single most powerful Eldar pirate force operating in the galaxy. Yet when he heard of Highfleet Kraken's assault on Yondan, Prince Yuriel did his best to ignore the terrible perils that threatened his old Craftworld. But proud though he was, righteously angry though he remained, Yuriel would not leave Yondan's people to their fate in this darkest hour. Battling his way through the Tyranid psychic blockade, Yuriel swept to the aid of his people and arrived just in time. Like a thunderbolt from the blue, Yuriel and his large Eldar Raider fleets smashed into the swarm of Tyranid vessels. He was quickly joined by a few remaining crafts of Yondan's fleet, and together the combined Eldar space fleet tore the swarm of Highfleet Kraken apart. Two more waves of Tyranid hive swarms from the Kraken attacked the Craftworld, only to meet the same fate. Not a single Tyranid bioship reached the Craftworld, though the cost of Yuriel Eldrick's raiders was dear. Bloodied but outbowed, the raiders prepared to sell their lives to the last in order to turn back the next wave of Tyranids. On the bridges of the Craftworld and of the circling Eldar starships, vigilant eyes watched the scanners waiting for the first tall tale blip that would indicate the direction of the next assault. Minutes passed, then hours, and with a growing sense of wonder, the Eldar realized that no more Tyranid swarms were coming. The assault was over. Highfleet Kraken had been dispersed. Its cohesion had been destroyed. But on Yondan Craftworld, the war raged on. The Tyranid hordes had been fighting a tenacious rearguard action, awaiting the aid of the rest of the Highfleet, now turned like cornered rats and hurled themselves at the Eldar. Caught by surprise, the Eldar staggered back, desperately trying to hold in the face of suicidal Tyranid onslaught. The Fortress of the Red Moon fell to a surprised attack, and for a moment it seemed that with victory within their grasp, the Eldar would yet be defeated. But for a second time, Yuriel led his Eldric Raider to the rescue of the Craftworld. Disembarking from their orbiting spacecraft, the Raiders joined with the battered defenders of Yondan Craftworld, and yard by yard, step by step, forced the Tyranids back. A final wild charge led by the Tyranid High Fleet was annihilated by the combined efforts of the Avatar of Kane, Prince Yuriel, and the Ghost Warriors, and then, in a series of vicious, one-sided battles, the last of the Tyranids were hunted down and destroyed. The Tyranid attack on Yondan Craftworld was over. The Tyranids had been defeated. But the victory was a hollow one. There, the Eldars had repulsed the invaders. The cost was enormous. Their once proud Craftworld stood in ruin, and 4/5 of the inhabitants were dead or lay dying in the shattered halls. Amongst their number lay Farseer Kelmon, surrounded by the bodies of a dozen Tyranid Zoanthropes, whose wretched heads bore the marks of psychic fire. Yondan's mighty space fleet was a pitfall shadow of its former self, the blasted remains of its majestic spacecraft and their brave crews, hanging silent and weightless in space. But all this could be rebuilt, maybe not for hundreds of generations, but one day in the distant future. What was lost forever were the souls of the Eldars, whose spirit stones had been destroyed in the battle against the Tyranids. The massive destruction brought upon the people and the ghost warriors of Yondan dealt the Craftworld and the entire Eldar species a blow from which its culture could never fully recover. Highfleet Kraken was little more than splintered fragments of his former might, yet credit could not lay entirely with the Eldar defenders, nor the actions of the Ultramarines on Ikra 4. The Eldar and the Imperium had fought as unwitting allies. Had the Kraken not struck Yondan, the Ultramarines' victory on Ikra 4 would have been impossible, and vice versa. Had either Ikra 4 or Yondan fallen, the Kraken would have proven unstoppable. The scattered remnants of the Tyranid attack on Ikra 4 fled toward the Galactic Core, driving with the Imperial defense perimeter that had been erected against Highfleet Kraken. These splinter fleets became an even greater threat to the Imperium as they fed upon unsuspecting and poorly defended worlds far from the main Tyrannic warzone in the eastern fringe of the galaxy. Running battles with these Kraken splinter fleets continue for many years after the Highfleet's passage, draining Imperial defenses against later Tyranid incursions. It is doubtful if the true extent of the destruction brought by the Kraken will ever be known to the adepts of the Administratum. The splinter fleets are comprised by as few as a dozen hive ships, but even a dozen of these living vessels are more than capable of overrunning a human world and harvesting its biomass so that it could become an even greater threat. Some Kraken splinter fleets have become so large through this method as to be classified by the Imperium as a new distinctive hive fleet of its own. Indeed, Highfleet Megalodon grew from one of the splinters of Kraken and continues to ravage portions of the Imperium in the present. With no doubt, the Tyranids as a whole have learned much of the Imperium's inner defenses from the actions of these splinter fleets. Every battle the Tyranids engage in, regardless of their outcome, adds to the hive mind's growing understanding of its new prey behavior and tactics. It may perhaps have been a true reason for the Highfleet's Kraken's existence to test Imperial defenses for the far larger Tyranid invasion of the Milky Way galaxy that is to come. If such strategic brilliance is a hallmark of the hive mind, then humanity, indeed all intelligent races of the galaxy, have much to fear in the coming days. The Imperium had barely enough time to breathe following the end of the Second Tyrannic War before it learned that both Highfleet Behemoth and Kraken had been little more than reconnaissance forces for the true threat to the very existence of humanity, the arrival of Highfleet Leviathan.
And those were 40 facts on Highfleet Kraken. I hope you guys enjoyed that giant compilation video. It's a video we did a while back, but we wanted to put part 1 and part 2 together just to have one cohesive long video you can play while you paint. More lore coming soon. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow. This was Gersh One with One Mind Syndicate signing out. Oh, if you could put my freedom first in